So for the last portion of our conference, we have invited staff working in the arts at the Queensland Curriculum of Assessment Authority to join us to talk about the external exam. Their presentation will focus on building teacher understanding of the effective practices to strengthen in preparing students to undertake the external assessment in drama. So please welcome Learning Area Manager for the Arts, Angela Pratt, and Principal Educational Officer, Michelle Vendee.
Well, good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for coming along. This is a bit of a unique experience for me because I think it's probably the first time that I've had the opportunity to present face-to-face to an audience since 2020. So that's really exciting to actually be in the same room with drama peeps instead of talking to you across a webinar or on the phone or via email. So thank you so much, DQ, for giving both Ange and I the opportunity this afternoon to come and chat with you. It's really wonderful to be here, and I hope that you've had a fantastic conference and that you feel really rejuvenated and energised by the opportunity to talk to all of your colleagues and see what people are doing in their classroom and get to familiarise yourself with some really engaging, amazing practices that are happening out there and share your own fantastic practice as well. I'd like to start this afternoon's presentation just by acknowledging country. We acknowledge the traditional owners of this land and pay our respects to elders past, present and future, for they hold the memories, traditions and cultures of Aboriginal peoples and Torres Strait Islander peoples throughout Australia. And I'd like to take this opportunity as well to hand over to Ange Pratt and welcome Ange this afternoon too. She's going to chat to you a little bit about, some changes that are happening in the drama space over the coming months. But Ange, I'll let you explain that.
I shall indeed. And I echo Michelle's thanks for having us here today. But I do need to make an announcement. Some of you might be already aware of this, but the lovely Michelle Vendee, who has been Principal Education Officer for Drama and Drama in Practice for the last few years, is being seconded within the QCAA, so she stays in our organisation, but she's going to work in the external assessment team. It is with a sad heart that I give her to the external assessment team.
For eight months,
yes, to the end of the year. So it's just a temporary secondment. But in Michelle's place, we also have an excellent drama practitioner in Michelle Murta. Michelle has joined us recently, and so Michelle is going to be taking on the role of Principal Education Officer in Drama and Drama in Practice. So I know you are in good hands. Michelle, if you're not familiar with who she is, I think most of you would be, but she's also our chief endorser currently. So we're on the lookout for a new chief endorser. We love to just mix it up a little bit in drama, so that's great. But yes, we do wish Michelle well, and we look forward to continuing to work with you as teachers as well and support you in the spaces that you work within. Did you want me to also do what I also wanted to do?
Absolutely.
Okay, great. I also just wanted to take the opportunity, as we're talking about external assessment, to thank all of you who have been markers over the past couple of years, markers, lead markers, and also last year we were able to have some of you work with us as chief markers, and I know that we've got some chief markers in the midst in our lovely Steph Tudor, Melissa Rouse, and also Michelle Murta. So thank you for those people. We also, you know, Deb Wall is our chief confirmer, and our chief endorser as Michelle Murta in the past year. But thank you to all of you who played your part in marking student work over the last 2 years. We so appreciate your involvement in that. We cannot do it without you, literally, but we love it. We love working with you in all of the spaces, and particularly as we're talking about external assessment, I wanted to thank you for your involvement in that. There are always opportunities for more of you to be a part of this party, though. So, look, I take the opportunity to say there are, if you go to Assessor Jobs, our Assessor Jobs app, there is an opportunity for you to apply to be an endorser or a confirmer. And I think this week, applications open for EA marking. So please, come along. Anyway, I'll leave it all to Michelle. She's really the star of this show.
I feel like she stole my thunder because I've even got a slide advertising
Michelle.
The fact that EA marking is opening up. She always steals my thunder. I'd like to because I work with a lot of you so closely to deliver both our internal assessment, quality assurance practices, and also our external assessment. And it's so, so important. And I really value everything that you bring to that space as assessors. So thank you to those people who are involved, and come on board those people who aren't, because as you're about to find out this afternoon, EA marking is the best PD you can do, and it helps you to prepare your students for the EA as well. So EA is a really important summative assessment practice in Year 12. It makes sure that basically our students at the end of that two-year course in drama are demonstrating what they know and can do under external assessment conditions. And it's really important that as we go forward from year to year, we continue to strengthen our practices in that particular area. So this afternoon's presentation is really about helping you to ensure that your students feel confident and capable before they walk into that exam room. That's what it's all about, making sure that they feel like they have the knowledge and ability to be able to write an extended response essay using the stimulus, unseen stimulus that they get in the exam, and of course responding to the recorded live performance that they viewed and discussed and broken apart in class beforehand. So key aspects that I'll be talking about this afternoon are making clear connections with that unseen stimulus and making sure that the students are able to relate that to the prescribed recorded live performance, because they need to do both in that exam. Deconstructing dramatic action through their analysis and evaluation, and making really, really clear that they understand the way the dramatic languages have been used in that recorded live performance, and they're able to unpack that in their analysis. I'll also be talking a little bit about how students analyse the way that those dramatic languages work together. And finally, building familiarity with those dramatic languages in terms of making sure students know and understand them from the Queensland curriculum point of view. So I'm just going to spend a little bit of time now showing you where everything is. And I apologise for some of you, I'm sure you access these things all the time and you know, but it's always useful to talk about where we can find particular resources and what resources are available to you in your preparations for the external assessment. So originally, QCAA provided a sample instrument, a mock instrument, EAMG, and a sample response for schools to use. And those resources are still on the portal and they're still available for teachers to use. Keep in mind that they were created at a certain point in time, and that point in time was before we had actually implemented the external assessment. So we now have other resources that you can use in conjunction with these, or if you like to replace these resources, which are, of course are the past papers. So we now have a 2020 past paper and a 2021 past paper that are up on the portal ready for you to access at any time. And it's important to keep in mind as well that not only are they on the portal, but on the QCAA public website, so that students and parents can access those resources too. So both of those are available. And of course, the 2020 and 2021 subject report are there to be accessed and used in conjunction with those resources. Always the syllabus is our point of truth, but the subject report gives us a really valuable insight into excellent practices and practices that need strengthening as we move from year to year. So it's a really great document, and I strongly encourage you to engage with that each year and have a look at the resources that are available there, because it is one of the places at the moment where we are starting to have some real student work presented to you as a resource for you to look at. And we're hoping that to be the start of that, but it's useful for your teaching practice and also for your students too, as you engage with that and see how things have gone in the previous year and where we're headed in the next year. So you can find those past papers in the portal under the Units 3 and 4 tab, as you see there under External Assessment. They're very easy to find. If you do have any difficulties finding anything, of course, you can always contact Michelle Murta and she can point you in the right direction as well. And then the subject report is located, as I said before, on the portal in the Additional Resources tab, but you can also find it on the public website. If you just Google subject report drama 2021 Queensland, it comes up. And while the subject report provides information on internal assessment practices and a lot of the information that is provided for you there comes from those quality assurance processes, this afternoon our focus is really going to be on external assessment in terms of subject data and learnings from the 2021 cohort and what we found in terms of the marking operation. So some of the advice I'm going to give for you this afternoon comes from our leads and our chief markers, as well as my own observations as somebody overseeing the marking operation. So I'm hoping that you will find that useful. I did say we were going to talk briefly about data. The data we're mostly looking at this afternoon is qualitative rather than quantitative, but here you can see the spread of results for the external assessment for drama in 2021. In 2021, as in 2020, the stimulus included unseen visual and also text-based stimulus that was related to the three last year recorded live performances. This year we have two recorded live performances. Boy Girl Wall is in its second year, and of course we have our new text that's on the list, The Arrival. If you are looking for information about those texts, you can find it also on the portal in the resources section in the EA space under the memo for the prescribed recorded live performances. And those come out each year around about the time when the students have sat the exam. You get that for the following year. And of course, for this particular task that students undertake in the EA, they are required to write an extended response of between 800 and 1,000 words, and they have 2,000 hours, that's a long time. They have 2 hours in which to complete that response, and it's an analytical and evaluative response. Those cognitions are key, and I'll talk about that a little bit later as well. So we had some really wonderful effective practices that we could see in the marking operation and some great improvements in the ways in which students were responding. Firstly, effective practices that we saw across the board were that basically students are now understanding how to use an extended analytical format for their response. So nearly every complete student response that we saw come through in the marking operation was written as an analytical essay, structured in that extended response format, which is, of course, what we need and want to see students doing. Additionally, effective practices were also evident when students were drawing their knowledge of the elements of drama specifically from the Drama General Senior Syllabus 2019 and looking at the dramatic languages with the understanding of how we view them in Queensland. We have had some instances where students are, in their extended response and in their analysis and evaluation, selecting elements that sit outside of what we see in our syllabus. It's really key and really important that as we are teaching our students about the dramatic languages and familiarising them with those dramatic languages, that we are using that syllabus as our point of truth and not deviating from that. And we saw a big improvement in that in 2020. From 2020. However, I believe there is still room to improve there. So there are still instances where students are selecting either conventions or elements that would not be accepted as particularly elements of drama in Queensland. So just keep that in mind when your students are preparing, that they know it must come from our syllabus and not from outside. The other important thing that I'd like you to consider when students are selecting those elements of drama is that they're not double dipping with their elements and their conventions, and that they are selecting the most appropriate element for the text that they are discussing. as an example, paper sky, movement as an element, great. There's going to be lots to talk about and lots to unpack. And students find those elements are rich. There's lots for them to use in terms of key moments of dramatic action and deconstructing that dramatic action and analysing it. Language for paper sky, much more challenging. So encourage your students, when they're thinking about the elements, to choose and consider those elements that are really going to link to that particular performance that they are viewing, the style of the performance and what they can actually see taking place on in terms of stage dramatic action. A well-structured response in terms of effective practices also identified a suitable concept where a concept wasn't specified in the production, in the question. And they also chose to unpack that concept throughout their response as a through line arguing a position. That is one of the cognitions that students need to demonstrate in their response. So it's really important that we see that come throughout and that students are actually demonstrating that they understand what the concept is and how it links to the recorded, prescribed production that they're viewing. And then finally, in effective responses, we saw the inclusion of the most relevant key moments. So students were very selective. They chose key moments that were going to work in with that dramatic meaning that they were discussing, with that concept, and they were able to analyse and evaluate using appropriate drama terminology. So let's take a look at some sample responses from the questions. Now, I have provided the questions up here for you just as a cue, because I'm sure that not everybody has the 2021 EA paper memorised. But we're going to, they'll also be on the other screens when we look at student sample responses as well. They're just really small, so keep that in mind as you're looking here. Don't forget too that everything that you see in this presentation this afternoon is available either in the past paper on the QCAA portal, or it is on the subject report as well. So if you want to access these resources and look at them more closely, then please do that using those resources. So all of the questions we're looking at this afternoon come from the 2021 paper. Later on, we're going to talk about deconstructing questions, and we'll look at some of the past papers, including the sample and the mock, and how the questions have changed slightly over time. This first question included a definition of the butterfly effect and was in response to boy-girl wall. This is question two. And the question was, how effectively is the concept of the butterfly effect, as defined, communicated through key moments of dramatic action and meaning in boy-girl wall? Argue a position by evaluating the use of one key convention in relation to two elements of drama. So here we have a response. I'm not quite sure how big that is for you. Hopefully you're able to see it easily, but I'm going to chat about it anyway and pull bits out. So basically, you can see up there the EAMG performance level descriptors for the highest performance level. And effective student responses for the explaining and analysing the elements of drama criterion identified an element of drama that was listed in the drama general syllabus. They recognised and named it. They explained the characteristics of the use of the element accurately and in detail. They provided clear and detailed description of key moments to show how the element is manipulated to create dramatic meaning. And they provided valid and convincing judgments on how effectively the element is manipulated to communicate the concept, using detailed and credible examples to support these judgments. It's important there that you note the word judgments plural. In effective responses, we needed to see that students made more than one judgment. So their evaluation was detailed and they had more than one moment or more than one assertion to make in their response. In this response, you can see highlighted in yellow that we have where the student has specifically analysed the element of relationship. The bits highlighted in green demonstrate where the student has used evaluative language or moved into that evaluation. And I think it's important too to note that in this particular instance and in all of the samples I'm showing you this afternoon, this is just a tiny snapshot of a larger response. Unfortunately, we aren't able to provide full responses in the subject report. However, what we've tried to do is show you an example of where it has been used in a response. So just keep in mind that it won't be the only example in a student response. It will be one example of perhaps many. So this student response demonstrates how that student can recognise and name the element. They explore and explain the interaction between the characters. So they talk about Tom and Alethea and their parents. They also talk about the idea or the concept of the butterfly effect in relationship to that explanation of the element of drama. And then they go further with relationship and they talk about relationship to the environment. So the student actually talks about Tom and Alethea's relationships with their jobs, their hobbies, and of course that all important crack in the wall that ultimately brings the two characters together. So this student has interwoven throughout their response both analysis and evaluation clearly synthesised together, which is an important skill in the EA and assists the student in really unpacking and demonstrating their knowledge and showing those interrelationships and the way that those things work together. Moving on to the next question. This next student response deals with boy-girl wall again, question one, as seen here. In this question, you can see the image that students were provided with as an unseen visual. So we have an image of a person inside a chalkboard drawing of a box that has a little hole in the top and a thought bubble coming out of it. It's important to note that where students aren't provided with a concept, there's no one right answer. So as long as the student can clearly show links between the stimulus and the text that they are discussing and the dramatic meaning of that text, and they can make that really clear and argue that position, that is absolutely fine. We do not, as markers, have an answer sheet down the side that says that if in engaging with this stimulus where the concept wasn't specified, students must talk about this, this, and this, and if they don't mention those things with this stimulus, then it's wrong. That's not the way that we mark. We're looking to support the student, the judgments and decisions that they make, and the interpretation that they have of that image and how well they can link it. And I have to say, in 2020, some of the interpretation of the stimulus that we had in that paper amazed me, and some students had made some connections that I had never thought of but thought were incredibly clever, particularly under the stress of you're in a room for 2 hours, write me an exam to prove what you know about drama. It was incredible. So get your students to practice using the stimulus, both the visual images and also the text-based stimulus, and get them to really engage with making meaning from that and connecting it to the prescribed recorded live performance. They can come up with some amazing stuff, some really rich work, so they really get to demonstrate what they understand about the dramatic meaning of that text. In this question, students were asked to argue a position connecting an interpretation of the image or the concept with the key moments of dramatic action and meaning communicated in boy-girl wall. And they were asked to justify their response by evaluating the manipulation of one key convention in relation to the elements of character and space. This is a good example in this particular student response of how a student can take the convention and also take elements and really start to connect those dramatic languages and talk about how they work together. And again, it's worth acknowledging this is one snapshot of something that a student went on with much further, and I believe actually in the subject report there is more of this. I just couldn't fit it in our presentation today, but you can go and have a look at what else the student wrote in terms of unpacking the convention for this particular criterion, which is analysing conventions. So the student identified a key convention by recognising and naming it. They explained the characteristics of the use of the key convention accurately and with detail, and they provided a clear and detailed description of key moments to show how the key convention is manipulated to create dramatic action and meaning. So this student response excerpt demonstrates how the convention of multiple role-taking can be clearly evidenced through the use of credible examples, taking that dramatic action, deconstructing it. There are evaluative statements there about the effective use of the convention, supported by a focus on the skills of acting, and also referring to those elements of character and space. So the student talks about the manipulation of movement in the stage space and how the transition occurs between the characters. So we get a real sense that this student understands what the convention of multi-rolling is and how an actor manipulates that technique to change from one character to another. For example, this statement, when playing Dennis, Alethea's father, stands stage left, and when he plays Kathleen, Alethea's mum, he stands on stage right, using a twirl to shift between characters integrated into their dance moves. So the response directly links that analysis of the convention, multiple role taking, to the specified elements of drama that they've been given, character and space, and they also accurately focus their analysis and evaluation on the chosen convention of multiple role-taking rather than mistakenly talking about role. And I mentioned before about double-dipping with students. It's really important that students, when they are talking about convention and element, that they understand the difference between those two things and in particular make choices that make it easier for them in their analysis. So if they're talking about multiple role-taking and they select a convention of role, or if they're talking about stylized movement and they select, element of role, and they select the element of movement, it becomes really challenging and difficult for the student to differentiate their analysis and to clearly show that they've analysed both the convention and the element. So encourage them to think about how they can choose elements that are going to support their discussion of the convention without the risk of talking about the same thing twice, essentially, which is what you sometimes see. And this final example is a response to Paper Sky, question one. The stimulus showed a visual image of an arm reaching towards light. And if you look at that, and I'll say again, it's open to interpretation, but if you look at that visual, there is a sense that perhaps it's underwater. You can see by the quality of the light, but there was no requirement for students to talk about that. There was no requirement for students to, you know, make those really, really direct close links, although some did, and that was wonderful, as long as they are able to demonstrate their interpretation. And in this case, they were given the concept. They had to talk about rescue. So students were asked to argue a position, connecting the concept of rescue reflected in the image with key moments of dramatic action and meaning communicated in Paper Sky. And they had to justify their response by evaluating the manipulation of two elements of drama in relation to one key convention. And in this student response, we see the interrelationships between the element of drama and the key convention in relation to the question. There are three things the student needs to do here in order to get the top marks. They have to talk about the convention, they have to talk about the element of drama, and they must talk about the concept. That's what we mean by the question. They're linking that concept and stimulus back into their discussion of the dramatic languages. Sometimes students, when they're structuring their response, tend to have a throwaway line at the end of a paragraph that links back to the stimulus or links back to the dramatic meaning of the production, but it's the only time they do it. And in some instances, it's the same sentence that you see repeated throughout the essay. That's not making a discriminating and high-level connection with the stimulus and with the production and the dramatic meaning of it. We want to see that through line coming through where students are showing how this all works together and showing that they really understand that question and the stimulus and the dramatic meaning of the production all together. We did see an improvement in this in 2021, so it's still definitely something that we could say we've seen some good practice, but again, there's room for improvement with this particular criterion. This student excerpt shows evidence of analysis of complex relationships between their element of drama, which is symbol, and their convention, which is chorus. Nice, different convention and element that will work really effectively when talking about Paper Sky. They draw meaning together by referring to the unseen stimulus. The student specifies moments of relevant dramatic action to support the analysis linked closely to the meaning of the production. For example, and I'm just going to draw out this statement from the student response. As he lands, Henry and his chorus slowly reveal ripped pieces of Rose's photograph that has now been arguably transitioned into a symbol of loss of connection, conveying that Henry must accept his guilt and the fact that he cannot hold on to his dark past forever, as that is what is keeping him from being saved. That is a rich response and so beautifully linked to that stimulus as well. So we're seeing some really thoughtful ideas coming through that go beyond a possibly pre-prepared statement, and I'll talk about that in a little bit as well, where the student has really made that connection with the stimulus, really thought about it in relation to Paper Sky. It should be noted that students were more successful for this criterion, as I said before, when they'd selected those distinct elements and conventions that didn't double dip. So for example, this student selected symbol and chorus. It allows them to deconstruct that action, revealing clear and distinct insights into two quite different dramatic languages, where students selected a convention and then chose an element of drama that was related, as I said before, stylized movement and movement. It then became difficult for them to do this and challenging to analyse both. I know I'm repeating that a lot, but it's a key and important idea and concept that we saw coming up a few times in the marking operation. Practices to strengthen. It's recommended that when you're teaching your students and you're thinking about ways in which you can improve on last year's results, that firstly you start with the subject matter, and really work to familiarise your students with that at every possible opportunity. It's their bread and butter. It's the recipe they're using to create their drama works. So they should be talking about it all the time in their classroom. When they're providing feedback to their peers, encourage them to use the language of the subject. They should be using drama terminology, and they need to use it with confidence. So help your students to feel that they can talk about drama and performance works using and drawing on that language from the syllabus in a way that's going to flow for them, so that they're not getting into the exam and feeling like, okay, I've got my elements memorised, I've got my conventions memorised, and now I can regurgitate this into my essay. That's not what we want students to do in preparing for the external assessment. They should be demonstrating to us their knowledge that they have gained over the breadth of the course and the depth of the knowledge that has developed as they've continued to do their internal assessment and to engage with that, and also with you in the classroom talking about dramatic works that they've viewed, both their peers performing their own work and the work of professionals. So the other thing that I think that is important when you're considering your students is that you look really closely at conventions and what a convention is as opposed to an element of drama, but also as opposed to a theme. We have had lots of responses where students connect with a thematic idea or a trope that they view in the recorded live performance, and they latch onto that as a convention, and consequently they're unable to deconstruct dramatic action because what they're talking about is an idea, for example, power. It's not a convention, so they're not going to be able to talk about how an actor has manipulated it and used it to create dramatic action. So make sure your students are familiar with the conventions that go with the various styles that we study in drama across the course, and that they understand what those conventions are and how they work and how they're used by actors and directors in performance. The next practice to strengthen is about written literacy skills. So I mentioned before about students structuring their essay in a particular way and having memorised phrases or lines that they're keeping in the back of their head that they can then use in the exam. probably not the best way for students to approach the task because it tends to be repetitive. But also, if they've memorised large chunks of an essay and it's not relevant to the question, there are then large chunks of their response that they can't get any marks for. And this even goes to introduction and conclusion. We see some very beautiful introductions and conclusions that clearly students have memorised. They've pre-prepared those to bring in to the exam with them so they won't need to think about it. Introductions should be very brief. They just need to tell us essentially which text they're talking about. They need to make that link to the concept in it and the dramatic languages that they're going to be discussing. That's all we want to know. The body of their essay, those paragraphs in the middle between the introduction and the conclusion, they're the important thing. That's what they're being marked on. So please tell your students not to worry about creating really beautiful, long introductions that sometimes go on for 2 pages. They can be very long. They're not necessary. All that student is doing is eating away at the time that they have to actually respond to the recorded live performance and the question because they need to write all of this stuff down. And it is a way, I think, for students to manage their anxiety about an exam, but it's not the best way to manage that. The best way for them to manage that is to make sure they're familiar with the production, that they feel comfortable talking about it and, you know, answering questions that might come out from nowhere that they can then, you know, in class, that they can then say, hey, yeah, I know about that, I can talk about this. That's important. The other thing too is where they tend to memorise a sentence or a phrase that they'll use to talk about something, and then that we'll see that peppered throughout the response. Encourage them to write in response to the question. We have also seen some students responding to last year's paper, and that is a risk when you are using a paper to prepare students that may have questions on it. For example, the 2021 paper has questions on boy-girl wool. Boy-girl wool will be examined again in 2022. Students should not assume that the questions are going to be similar to the questions that were asked in 2021, or that they're going to be asked the same thing. And if they prepare an essay for that, it will work in this instance. They are automatically moving so far away from what they're being asked to do that they're going to be in that lower mark range. So while I have recommended to you using those past papers for revision purposes, I think it's really important that students are not using them to write essays, memorise those essays, come into examinations. I know it seems like, of course, but sometimes students do funny things when they're anxious and worried about an exam. So the more that you can provide them with original questions and original stimulus materials to engage them in thinking about the text in different ways, the better off they'll be because they will actually have thought about it in a variety of contexts instead of just this lens and going into the exam with that same lens. The other thing is avoiding a formulaic essay structure. So be careful where students are using a very common formula that we see of element-element convention in their response, that they are still making those connections of how the dramatic languages work together. Sometimes we see students who've only talked about the element here and nothing else, and then the second element here and nothing else. And sometimes this second element gets a much briefer Guernsey than the first one. So we've had quite a detailed analysis. Maybe time's run short and we've got a little tiny one here. It's not linked to the convention at all. They haven't mentioned the convention in element, element. And then they get down to the convention and they talk about that, but they don't talk about its relationship with the elements. They need to talk about those things together. So while it's acceptable for students to use particular essay structures, there's nothing stopping them from doing that. Make sure that they understand that they do need to talk about the way the dramatic languages work together, their interconnectedness, because that's very important. Cognition's a key. So teach your students strategies for using evaluative language. I know I said before, don't have your students trying to memorise lots and lots of lists because they should know it intuitively, but I think it can help students to be familiar and to have a vocabulary of evaluative language. I have no vocabulary at the moment, clearly, a vocabulary of evaluative language that they can draw upon, and that they know some terms that they can talk about that are clearly evaluating, and that they also understand that to evaluate means you're making a judgment on something. So we need to see evidence of that judgment in their response as well. So there's no harm in having your students, particularly when they're preparing for IA2, because that analysis and evaluation section of that internal assessment task is a little bit of a practice for our EA at the end. Get them to actually read through their response and to clearly highlight and identify where they can see that they have actually made a judgment and they have evaluated it and they've justified it, they've substantiated it, because that sometimes is missing as well. That's a really, really important aspect of that particular cognition that sometimes we don't see in student responses. Of course, the other thing is to make sure that your students understand the difference between plot and dramatic action. They need to talk about the actors in the space, on the stage, performing, not tell a storyline, which we do sometimes see as well. So we want to see that unpacking, that deconstruction of what's happening here coming through in the student responses, not them telling us what happens in Paper Sky. Tell them to assume the markers know what happens in that play. They are familiar with it. We don't want them to tell us the storyline. That's not going to help them to get those upper level marks. And then finally, we're going to talk about deconstructing the question. I'm hoping I'm going okay for time. Okay, great. All right, well. Okay, I'll make it brief, because in this next part, I'm going to talk about how you can deconstruct the question with your students and teach them this skill so that they understand the different parts of the question and exactly what they're being asked to do. That is a skill that students can learn, and they learn it through practice. So give them lots of different exam questions for drama, give them lots of different exam, and actually make them write exam questions. There's no better way to make sure that you understand the kinds of things that are asked in an exam question than to write one yourself and tick off and make sure, yes, I've actually covered everything here. And then you can steal them and you can use them. So it's actually a double whammy. It helps you and it helps them as well. But basically, they need to draw on those specific aspects of that stimulus in their response as well. So get them to choose stimulus items too. Get them to pull those things together and bring those in and talk about them and deconstruct one another's exam questions so that they really start to get an understanding about the sorts of things they have to do, the cognitive aspects that they're going to be demonstrating in their response. So let's have a look at a question in a little bit more detail. I'm just going to quickly skim past this because this is all available for you in a presentation that's already on the QCAA portal. So this is not new information. If you don't recognise it, then please access the resource that is from 2020 and talks about the external assessment for drama, unpacking it, because it goes into quite a bit more detail than the presentation in 2021, and it does have all of this key information about the questions and the way that they are structured. So an extended response question may consist of a number of components, and you can see those there on the screen. We have a command, we have a question, we have the subject matter, we have the context or concept, and we have the stimulus. A command basically gives the students the cognitive processes that they're going to have to use in order to respond to the question. So they might be asked to justify, evaluate, analyse, or argue a position as evident in the assessment objectives. It's important to note that some cognitive processes are subsumed in higher order. So demonstrate, you won't see, but we assume that students will demonstrate. It's just that we'll see it in a higher order analysis or evaluation cognitive term. If your students don't know what it means to argue a position, that's something that they need to know. They need to understand that they are going to be talking about this through line that comes through their whole essay and making it clearly linked to that context. That's their argument of a position, where they're telling us something about the true dramatic meaning of this text. A smaller question can then be seen inside the larger question. Generally, our extended response questions are one... Actually, not generally. They're kept to a limit of one to two sentences. Generally, in drama, now they tend to be two sentences at the moment, or they were last year. It will also ask them for relevant subject matter, which I've talked about already, the dramatic languages. In this case, we have elements and we have... dramatic conventions that we're asking students to unpack. And then finally, it will refer to the text-based stimulus or the unseen visual stimulus that they must discuss in addition to the recorded live performance that they viewed. And they need to be prepared for variations in this regard. It's important to note that students should not go into the exam thinking, I know exactly what I'm going to see in these questions, because that is setting them up for a situation where if something is not quite as it might be expected, that immediately it creates nerves and anxiety. So tell your students to be prepared for the questions to not necessarily be exactly like they were last year. In fact, they have to know it's not going to be exactly like last year, otherwise it's not an unseen exam anymore. Likewise, both the stimulus and the recorded live performance must be discussed. They cannot just go in and talk about the recorded live performance expecting that they're going to get high results. It just won't happen. So make sure that they understand that that connection to the stimulus is really key. And also, the extended response question is going to tell them to do that. So they need to look for where in the question that happens. Okay, I'm going to quickly skim through some of this. I just want to briefly talk about how the questions have changed over time. So here you see the 29 sample, the 2020 past paper and the 2021 past paper. And there are some key differences in these questions. So as I just mentioned previously, the structure can change from year to year. There can be differences. So prepare your students to go in expecting that it might not be exactly the same as it was last year. They don't need to have those preconceived notions. So the recorded live performance is indicated, as well as the fact that students must refer to the unseen visual or text-based stimulus related to their selected question from the question book in their response. And I'm going to really skim through this really quickly because I had an activity that I wanted you to do. I'm not sure I'm going to get time to do it, but I would really love you to have an opportunity to actually talk to one another about the EA for a brief moment. So I'm going to just quickly talk about this. So as you can see in this, we've got the 2019 paper. It says, in the cartoon, 2020, use this image. 2021 past paper, as described in the quote. You can also use something similar with your students to unpack the way questions change or questions might be different and get them to identify where they can see those key aspects of question construction happening. So we have in each question a command that's asking students to provide evidence to justify a viewpoint. In the 2019 sample, they're asked to examine the dramatic meaning communicated. In the 2020 past paper, they are required to examine the dramatic action and meaning communicated. So we can see there's something added there that wasn't there before as a cue for students. In the 2021 past paper, they are directed to evaluate key moments of dramatic action and meaning. The subject matter is to be the focus of the student response, and that's indicated there for us. In the 2019 sample, we have the key convention of motif and two elements of drama that are not specified. In 2020, we have the elements of drama, dramatic focus and symbol, and the key convention can be selected by the student. And in the 2021 past paper, the element of drama relationship is provided, and students are required to select one key convention and one element. The context or concept is left open to students' interpretation, and this is made clear in 2019 through the phrase, the message in the cartoon. In 2020, they're asked to use this image, and in the 2021 paper, they're asked to argue a position using the provided context, challenge the concept of a carer's role. And then finally, the cognitive processes are to be demonstrated. The command is made clear by the phrase, argue a position. And this command's the same because it's actually one of our assessment objectives. So it's used in that, it's that cognition specified for the task. You'll note that in the two past papers, students are provided more explicit instruction to evaluate than they were in the 2019 sample. So they asked in 2020 to argue a position and talk about how effectively something is done. And in 2021, they were asked to argue a position evaluating something. And then we can pull it all together like so.